Almost everything requires some level of faith. Every time I sit down on a chair, I exercise faith that it is going to hold me up. However, most of our faith steps are in tandem with testing and proving. Why is it when it comes to our religious beliefs, we think that it is any different? Many believe what they believe because they simply want to. They are taking a big step of faith. But what if we could shrink that gap a bit? Our belief still requires faith, but what if we could examine certain things that would allow the gap to close between what we know and what we hope for? We can close the gap on our faith so that the steps we are taking are actually the most logical conclusion we can come to.
Well, good morning and welcome to Envoy, where we are a people following Jesus. To those not yet, I want to echo what Sean just mentioned. We're doing a This Is Us class right after the second service, and I would love to just personally invite you guys, whether you've been, like this is your first time, or you've been coming here recently, or you've never been through this particular class. It's not a membership thing, we're not signing your life away, but it gives us an opportunity to get to know you and for you to know us and what we're all about and get to meet some other people that are kind of on that recent journey here at Envoy. And so we'd love to have you come. It's not too late to be able to join us for that. That being said, we are closing up our series called Closing the Gap. We've been in the last 3 weeks, and what we've been doing is we've been having this conversation about when it comes to faith. We have faith steps in everything that we do. Almost everything that we believe actually requires some degree of faith. In other words, there's a gap of understanding or knowledge that exists that we have to be able to step over. But when it comes to our spiritual faith and our belief in things, oftentimes we take these huge, gigantic leaps and steps, and we might be okay with that. But the people around us look at that and they're like, how is it that you believe what you believe? And they see this big step of faith, and we don't have anything to be able to offer them in defense of why it is that we do what we do. But I truly believe in our spiritual faith journeys, we can actually close the gap on our faith steps to where we come to a place where you go, the most logical conclusion I can come to is that in the last couple weeks we've been talking about it, that there is a God. That's one of the first ones we did. And so we took these steps where we took a look at some of the clues that would actually like point to the existence of God. And what we've been trying to do is simplify these concepts so that it's like really easy for not only you for to be able to grasp, but also to present to someone else. And at this level, basically, we get down to a point where we go, guys, there either is a God or there is no God. That those are the only two options. And if there's even the possibility that there is a God, it's worth your time actually checking out. You should go do that. And then last week, we took a look at Jesus is God, and we took a look at the fact that he's a real historical person who lived, just like Christopher Columbus and Abraham Lincoln, all those kind of guys. He really made an impact in this life that we still feel today in our homes, in our society, in our culture. We looked at how other religions actually have great things to say about Jesus, but you have to come to the conclusion of whether you believe that he is God. And when he comes down to it, C.S. Lewis put it about as eloquently as we could, he's either a liar, he's a lunatic, or he is the Lord of your life. And so we've been taking a look at those things. This week, we're actually turning our attention to the Bible is the Word of God. And what we're going to do is do the same thing that we've done in the last couple weeks. We're going to be taking this big step of faith that most of us take about the Bible being the Word of God, and we're going to shrink that down a little bit to where we can come to some conclusions and maybe some resolutions in your own heart and life. As we get started with that, what we're going to do is I'm going to turn it back over to you all, and we're going to do a table talk time. We haven't done this in the past few weeks, and so we're kind of reintroducing that a little bit. We truly believe that if we want to get people to engage and be equipped the very best they can on a Sunday morning, which is our primary premise, that being able to interact with other people and have conversations really helps you to be able to sort those things out and get your minds ready for what we have to be able to share with you. And so I'm going to turn it over to you guys. We got a table talk time. It's going to be 3 minutes, and so it's kind of brief, but these are the questions I want you all to talk about at your tables or in your individual areas up there. First of all, do you believe the Bible is trustworthy? If so, why do you believe the Bible is the Word of God? And if not, why not? And just be really honest with each other about this. You got 3 minutes. Introduce yourself. Go.
All is forgiven. Trading your chains of bondage.
for crowns of freedom. All are welcome at the table. There is a place just for you. No condemnation at the table. There is a place just.
Is the Bible the Word of God? That's what we're going to be tackling today. I so appreciate you all jumping in. I know 3 minutes is not enough for some of you. For others of you, 3 minutes is like an eternity, all right? So I'm just giving you all, splitting the gap, all right? But here's the deal. We started the conversation. I want us to continue that conversation. I'm going to be talking for a little bit here today about this. I'm going to give you all some direction on some stuff, but it's going to require some additional steps on your part and hopefully some additional conversation within your homes and your small groups, within your friend groups, because these are the kind of questions not only that are burning kind of in our hearts and our minds. Some of us have taken this big step. We go, yeah, I believe the Bible's the Word of God, but I have no clue why I actually believe that, right? And then many of us will have friends or relatives or neighbors or coworkers that wrestle with this very thing, and we should be able to offer them some intelligible direction. And nothing that I'm going to say here today is going to concretely be able to offer you guys the evidence that the Bible is the Word of God. There's still a step of faith that we all are going to have to take, that we actually believe that this was inspired by God. It was penned through him by people into this compilation that we have today, right? But ultimately, each of us are going to have to take that step, but we don't have to take this huge step. So we're going to be whittling that down a step at a time as we close the gap. The first thing I want to talk about and the first step we're going to take is the unique and unified composition of the Bible. This is really kind of an interesting thing. And in and of itself, this is not like proved that the Bible is the Word of God, but it certainly helps us to take a step. Most of us understand this and know it, but the Bible is not simply a book. It is one Bible that we have that we've called, right, that is broken up into two testaments, the Old Testament and the New Testament, these covenants that we have. It's written by 40 different authors, so it's not some guy in a closet somewhere saying, hey, I'm going to go ahead and like write the history of the world and put all these things together, right? There's 40 different authors comprised of 66 books over a 1,500-year period of time. And that's actually what compiles the scriptures that we understand as the Bible. And so what's really amazing is when you take a look at this work, 40 different authors, over 1,500 years, there's this incredible theme that works its way all the way throughout the Bible. A consistent direction of the type of God that our God is, that it desires to reconcile and restore his people, pointing to this place and this person of the Messiah who we know as Jesus, and then giving us opportunities and instruction for life in the after, all right? So one Bible, two Testaments, 40 authors, 66 books in a 1,500 year period. Now, for the purpose of today's conversation, and as we kind of start to shrink the gap, we're going to be focusing primarily on the New Testament, so the second section of the Bible, if you will, for a couple reasons. One is that like we talked about last week, Jesus is God. He's the very representation of God. The New Testament is where we actually see Jesus being revealed to us. The Old Testament points to the need for a Savior, and it actually refers to this coming Messiah, but the New Testament allows us to be able to see this Jesus that we understand and know, and so we're going to be talking about that. Secondly, you all need to understand that the New Testament, specifically in the compilation of it, is the thing that oftentimes receives the greatest scrutiny. People have issues with what the Old Testament says, but they don't necessarily have issues with whether or not it was actually compiled as scripture for the Jewish people, because it was well documented and attested to and everything of that nature. And so we're going to be talking primarily about the New Testament as we hit on this, and we'll talk about it as a whole. With that being said, the New Testament itself was actually compiled or canonized in the Council of Hippo in 393 AD. This is when the New Testament books were kind of all put together. Now, for some of you guys, you're going, wow, that's a long time after Jesus. And it is. We're going to talk about that here in a minute. But there are early statements of these scriptures themselves actually being attested to and created list of long before they were ever finally canonized into the body of work we call the scriptures. In other words, we had people like Matthew and like Mark and like Luke and like John that ended up writing these accounts of the life of Jesus. And we had guys like Paul who ended up having encounters with Jesus, the resurrected Jesus, later on. And he ended up writing much of the New Testament that we have in the forms of letters to these churches. And we have his brother James, and we have Peter writing these other things that were all included in the ultimate, what we call the New Testament later on in 393. But what you need to know is this. These individual works all stand alone by themselves. Catch this. These works are not considered to be scripture because they are actually in the Bible. They're in the Bible because they were already considered scripture before we ever got to that point. And so these guys like Matthew, who was a tax collector, who Jesus saw something in and said, hey, I see something in you, I want you to follow me. He followed after Jesus for 3 years, watched, he was an eyewitness account to all this stuff, recorded different things, and he shared them orally and decided to actually go through and write them down. And his writings were not only circulated, but they were copied. Fragments were given to other people as Christians were like sought after to be killed and their documents to be burned. And so they saw these things as being precious and sacred long before they were actually ever included in the canon of scripture. So each one of these authors that compile and comprise the New Testament, these authors were actually considered to be inspired by God and their works to be considered scripture long before they were ever put in the body of work called the scriptures. And with that being said, oftentimes we may say, well, the Bible says, or the New Testament says, and I get that and I understand that we offer credibility and authority in that way, but it might actually be more impactful for people to be able to say, hey, can I talk to you about what John said about Jesus? You see, there's this guy named John who happened to be one of Jesus's best friends who followed him around for 3 years and got to be like on the inside circle with Jesus. And this is what he had to say about Jesus. All of a sudden, somebody actually opens up their ears a little bit different because they might not believe some of the other things that the Bible says, but the gospel of John, his writings, the best friend of Jesus, that might carry some more weight. Or for that matter, like James, the half-brother of Jesus, can I tell you what he said? Because you have to understand, James didn't even believe that Jesus was the Son of God until after the resurrection. I mean, think about this. Those of you all that had siblings, what would you have to do to convince your brother that you are the Son of God, right? I mean, this is a big deal. And yet, Yet this guy who wasn't on like Team Jesus on the front side, the scriptures actually attest to the fact that his family was like, hey, can you like quiet down over here, right? And then he ultimately comes to believe. So let me tell you what James actually has to say. You see how all of a sudden that gives some greater credibility to this. The book of the Bible is not a compilation of men. It was basically, what happened was is that these scriptures that had already been well attested to, it simply was inspired words and works of God that then they decided to put all together because they said, we need to be able to have this in a form where we all have this and accessible to us, okay? So that's one thing, all right? The compilation of scripture in and of itself is a testament to its validity. All right, let's take a look at the next one. We'll take a look at literary accuracy. As I mentioned before, some of these numbers are a little bit staggering to us, especially in our day and our Western world viewpoint. What happens is we look at the compilation of the Bible in 393 and we go, man, that's over 300 years after the time of Jesus. How can this be trusted? Has anybody ever had that kind of thought or mentality? Now, that's not when these documents were written or recorded, but that was when they were compiled. And so we have this issue. How can that be trustworthy if it was written that far away? First of all, you all need to understand that the oral culture of the Jewish people and people of that day was a spectacular thing, and that's actually how they carried on their tradition from generation to generation. And so they were primarily an orally based culture, not a written based culture. Yet some of the writings can actually be traced back to almost 30 years after the time of Jesus, all right? So that's pretty close. But then we even hear that and we go, I couldn't even write to you about what I ate last week, never mind 30 years from now, right? And so we hear that and we go, man, 30 years after the time of Jesus, how can that actually be trusted? You see, it's actually really important that we had eyewitness accounts that were being written during this generation after Jesus because it gives people an opportunity to be able to attest to or deny the things that were being said. And so like early documentation is really, really important and we need to understand that. So when we take a look at what is actually compiling the New Testament, what we understand is that there are certain works that were written about Jesus that people early on said, that's not actually true. And those things were omitted. They were never considered to be scripture, and therefore they were never included in what we have as the New Testament. Yet these things had circulated and were already considered scripture early on, and now we have them. So I don't know about you, but that gave me some consternation for a while, especially because I didn't understand how like we as a society hold literary works to be accurate and true. And so let me offer you a little bit of a manuscript comparison to help us understand this and bring this down a little bit more, because not only do we have early writings about the person of Jesus that could have been circulated early on, but in comparison to what we actually see as being historically accurate and true, you'll see that the Bible, it far outweighs the competition. Let's take a look at this chart here real quick. This chart's kind of made up of four categories. We have the author, we have a book, we have this time gap. What this represents is the time that the works were believed to be written and the earliest manuscripts that we have of that particular document. And the last one has to do with the number of copies. And so to do this, I'm gonna walk you all through stuff and offer you a little bit of a visualization with some coffee beans up here. But I want you to, this is just a few, by the way, of the list. There are other resources out there you can go take a look at and you can see much more extensive lists. But this guy Plato, anybody heard of Plato? We're not talking about like the stuff that you form in your hands, all right? Talking about the philosopher. He wrote this book called Dialogue, right? It was 750 years from the time that he actually wrote it to the earliest manuscripts that we have. And what we were told and what we see is that there are actually only seven copies. There's seven copies of that particular book. And we hold this to be true and accurate and verified. Okay. Next up, we've got Herodotus. He wrote the histories. 1,300 years from the time of his writing to the earliest manuscripts that we have. And what we see is that we have nine copies of his particular work. Next one up, Caesar wrote the Gallic Wars, 1,000 years removed from whenever he wrote it. We have 10 copies of it. Next one up, Tacitus wrote the Annals, 750 years, again, removed from when he wrote it to when we have it. 20 copies, all right? 20 copies of what he has. Homer's Iliad. Anybody have actually read the Iliad or have heard of the Iliad? You all see it. It's a fictional work, right? But this is the shortest period of time and the most amount of copies that we have in history, as we see. 400-year gap between when it was written and the earliest manuscripts. And as you'll see, we have 643 copies, all right? The Iliad blows all of these other guys away. This is amazing. Now, how does the New Testament actually compare to the historicity in terms of literary accuracy of these other books? Let's take a look at it, right? The New Testament was written, the earliest manuscripts that we have, actually some of those are even 50 years removed, but 100 years removed from when it was actually written and the earliest manuscripts we have. And holy moly, I'm gonna need a bigger cup here for this particular thing. I want you all to visualize this with me, all right? 5,868, and these are Greek manuscripts, all right, that we have. In terms of the number of these works that we, oh man, not enough. All right. As you all see, the New Testament blows away the ways in which we actually evaluate. You see, nobody actually is concerned about the accuracy, the literary accuracy of these other works. They're all well attested, and therefore they are well received. Yet for some reason, critics and skeptics try to be able to denounce what the New Testament actually has when we have all of this evidence, right? And this, by the way, only is considered of the Greek New Testament items. It has nothing to do with actually the additional languages that it was already translated in as well. If you were to add those to this, it would be another 20,000 copies of these manuscripts, okay? You all see that, like, this is ridiculous that we have this and we have this, and people debate the literary accuracy of the New Testament. Not only that, but you would think that with having this many manuscripts, then for certain you're going to have all sorts of discrepancies in these articles that we have, in these manuscripts, and these fragments of things, right? But when you actually take a look at these things side by side with all of these copies available to us, you see that there's a 99.5% accuracy rate. And the things that actually have any kind of discrepancy are typically spelling or grammatical errors, and they don't actually affect any of the major meanings or the tenets of faith. All right, with good confidence, guys, not only by the way in which these guys measure this, you know, this is not just a matter of, hey, the Bible actually meets literary accuracy. It blows away literary accuracy according to historical documentation. Okay, you all see that? You have confidence in this? We're going to take a step in a little bit further, okay? We know that the Bible is literally accurate. That moves us into this next category of historical verification, all right? Historical verification. The Bible, the New Testament, is not just a religious book. It's a historical document. It's made up of real people in real places that did real things. It talked about specifically in specifics of society and characters that can actually be traced and historically found to be true. We talked a few weeks ago about how science, specifically in the area of there is a God, science offers an immense amount of clues and evidences that point to the existence of God. It can neither prove nor disprove those things. But one particular branch of science is called archaeology. And archaeology is something that's been used in large part because people are trying to discover the past. They're trying to figure out, are the things that we have actually historically accurate? There are some people that go to great extents to try to disprove the Bible by digging things up from the past and going, see, I told you that this book is not actually accurate. It's not actually verified. The problem with that is that every time that we dig something up or we discover something new, you know what it does? It attests to, it confirms what the scriptures actually say. Now, just so you all know, archaeology is not meant to prove the Bible, all right? That's not the form of it. But it does have the ability to actually confirm the details of the scriptures. A famous archaeologist, Dr. Nelson Gluck, I have to say his name like that. And it says, it may be stated categorically that no archaeological discovery has ever controverted a biblical reference. Scores of archaeological findings have been made which confirm in clear outline or exact detail historical statements in the Bible. And by the same token, proper evaluation of biblical description has often led to amazing discoveries. A lot of these guys that had set out to kind of disprove the Bible have now started with the Bible in their hands because they go, this book actually tells about this place and this people, and they say it's supposed to be right here. And so they go, let's dig there, because archaeology actually confirms what the scriptures say. The Bible mentions kings and rulers and governors who were in fact people who really existed. And archaeology confirms Bible history. It often shows that Bible people and incidents are correctly referred to. Let me give you just one for instance to this, and you can go and research your own things on all this stuff. But again, one such team of people were looking at this and they're going, hey, Isaiah mentions this king of Assyria, his name's Sargon. We have no record in our Assyrian documents and histories of this particular god. That verifies the fact that the Bible is inaccurate, it's exaggerated, and it's telling falsehoods, right? Until they actually go through this discovery and they find Sargon's palace and they realize, oh wow, the Bible is actually speaking of, as a matter of fact, the Jewish historians are better historians than the Assyrian ones because they left out their king. You see, the Bible over and over again confirms, or the archaeology over and over again confirms what the Bible has to say. And I can understand actually why people would want to set out archaeologically to be able to disprove the Bible. Because if the Bible is accurate and the Bible is verified, then it might be true. And if it's true and it's verified and it's accurate, then what does that mean for me? That means that I gotta start actually living my life by what it says. I need to start giving it due authority and practicality in my own life. And so we see why people would set out to disprove it, but over and over again, it doesn't. Answers in Genesis is a resource that you all can go to. It's a great resource there. It makes this statement, says, it is remarkable that where confirmation is possible, because it's not always possible in history, but where it is possible and has come to light, the Bible survives careful investigation in ways that are unique in all literature. Its superiority to attack, its capacity to withstand criticism, and its amazing facility to be proved right are all staggering by any standards of scholarship. You know what's truly amazing? I was having a conversation with somebody a couple weeks ago about this as well. No other religious book receives the same kind of scrutiny that our book does. Have you all ever noticed that? Nobody's going around and talking about the historical or literary accuracies of the Quran or the Quran, right? No, nobody's doing that, right? They don't do that. For some reason, the New Testament specifically, but the Bible as a whole gets attacked by other people more and more. Why? Because I believe that they think that if it's actually true and if it's relevant, if it's verified, then they're gonna have to actually live by it. But the Bible over and over again talks about civilizations that are mentioned and the excavations that are discovered, historical events like wars and famines and earthquakes and censuses and forms of government and forms of punishment. They're all accurate according to historical documentation and archaeological discoveries. Whereas a lot of other religious documents are not that case. Just a case in point, if you look at the Book of Mormon, one of the things that is talked about in this particular deal is that they have all sorts of historical inaccuracies and incongruencies. They talk about animals that existed on certain continents that never did. They talk about historical lines that didn't actually happen. They talk about specific uses of tools and weapons that weren't in place during those particular time periods. Those are all things that you look at and you go, historically inverifiable, versus when we look at the Bible, we go, no, historically verifiable. Let's take a step closer in that one. Next one here, prophecies and promises. Prophecies and promises. Now, I want to make a distinction between this because the scriptures actually tell us, right? It says all scripture is God-breathed. In the New Testament, one of the authors makes this statement, all scripture is God-breathed and it's useful for correction and it's useful for equipping, right? It's useful for being able to steer us and give us direction. That's a wonderful quote. But what you can't do with a quote like that is to use the Bible to verify the Bible. All right, you can't use the Bible to prove the Bible in that case. You see, the New Testament writer said all scripture is God-breathed, and therefore it is, right? That's a circular logic. You can't use the Bible to actually prove the Bible, especially when that author didn't have the New Testament in the form that we had it, and so he wasn't even referring to this. He might have been referring to some of the things that had been written, but most likely he was referring only to the Old Testament at that point in time anyway, right? So you can't use the Bible to prove the Bible. However, you can actually use what's in the Bible to measure against the things that are in the Bible to be able to see if it's congruent or not. You can cross-reference things. And one of the cool things about the scriptures that are well-documented and historical and literarily accurate is that there are these amazing prophecies that take place in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. But in the Old Testament, these things that are written down hundreds or thousands of years in advance, you get to take a look and see, did those things actually take place or not? And so when you start to look at these things, you look at, oh, they spoke about this kingdom falling, and did it fall? Oh, yeah, it did. And they spoke about this king coming into place, and did he come? Oh, yes, he did. And they spoke of this Messiah, all these prophecies about the Messiah, and all of those things were fulfilled in Jesus of Nazareth, the real man who really existed. It's a staggering thing. And so you can actually look and see and examine whether or not the prophecies that are spoken of really exist, to take a step closer. One of my favorite things to be able to encourage people in is the promises of God. Because ultimately, all these other steps, like, you can take, and maybe like logically people don't care about these other things, but and maybe they're still not convinced that the Bible is the word of God. And one of the things that I can confidently do is say, hey, listen, if you don't believe it, how about you just read it? How about you just read it? Take a look at the New Testament. Take a look at just the Gospels of Jesus. Take a look at what he says and the promises, the many promises that he makes that are oftentimes conditional. He'll say, if you, then I will. Just test him out on that. Just give it a try and see if it doesn't actually play out in your life. Let me put you next to one of Jesus' teachings and the ways in which he tells us to live our life, and see if that's not actually a better way of living for you. You test it for yourself and see if this actually does not prove. Now, this is an experiential aspect of closing the gap, but it's one that I think is very, very important. It cannot stand alone, because like the Book of Mormon, somebody might hand that to you and they might say, hey, read it, and if you feel it's true in your heart, then it must be. Guys, that is only an evidence, right? We've seen all these other things, and whenever you put all of that into place and then you actually experience the truth of God's word, you're able to actually take a look and see how it's congruent with itself. You're able to taste and see that the Lord is good, because you put into practice his teachings and his promises. All of a sudden you go, I feel a lot more comfortable. As a matter of fact, I've come to a place where I go, I can't help but believe that the Bible is the word of God. Ultimately, that's where we have to come to. Is the Bible God's word? What we've determined already is the Bible is accurate, it's reliable, it's trustworthy, it's verifiable. It can be experienced. You still have to decide for yourself if it's the word of God. And if it's the word of God, then it is authority in our life. And I just got to speak this to you guys real quick. It's not in my notes, but I truly believe it. Many of you guys go, oh yeah, absolutely, I believe the Bible is the word of God. But you don't listen to it. You don't read it. You pick and choose the things from it that you actually want to be able to follow. You go, oh, that doesn't apply to me, right? But the New Testament is really clear in how it offers us a pathway to life. And so if we believe that it's the word of God, it should take effect in our life. It should actually be the authoritative source of truth and direction for us. Now, with all that being said, let me close the gap. Allow me to offer just a little bit of a use and a caution to the scriptures. Because I truly believe that the Bible is the word of God. I believe that it's the authority and the source of my life. And that's not just because I'm a pastor, all right? Like, I believe this. I'm a pastor because I believe that. Like, this is that I want to tell other people about this. But there's a few things that happen with the Bible that I've noticed, and I've had some conversations with others of you guys as well. And we just need to be aware of this. I hold a high view of Scripture and the New Testament and the Bible as a whole. But for some people, they take the Bible and they make it an idol. I don't know if you all have ever experienced this before. And what I mean by that is that some people, they actually hold the Bible on the same level as God. Like, the Bible is our God. Other people might even ask, I was having a conversation with a friend, and he said, do you really believe there's a God, or do you just believe in the Bible? And he was really positive about that, because for some people, the book is God. The book, it saves me. What you need to understand is that's not how it works. The Bible is not what saves us. It is the word and the works of our Savior that are captured in the pages, but the Son of God, Jesus Christ, is what saves us. His blood on the cross is what saves us. His Holy Spirit comes and guides us and directs us, and the Scriptures give us guardrails and instruction and direction for life. It is precious to me, but we need to understand the place that it plays in all this. And let me make a statement or a question. Do you need to be convinced that the Bible is the word of God in order to be saved, in order to surrender your life to Jesus? To which I would say, no. Now, that in no way diminishes this particular work. That in no way puts this aside and says, guys, don't teach it, don't talk about it. But what we need to understand is that for a large part of modern history, people didn't have the Bible the way that we have the Bible. And you know what? They still got to Jesus. Take a look at this. It wasn't compiled until the 4th century. We talked about that already. Even when it was actually compiled, it wasn't available through the printing press until about the 1400s, where we could actually print this and distribute it. Even when it was printed and distributed, for most people, it wasn't in the language that they understood and knew. And even when it was printed and available and compiled and made like available for other people, the majority of mankind was actually illiterate for most of our world history. And yet they still found a way to Jesus. Andy Stanley says it this way: the Bible did not create Christianity. Be very careful about this. The Bible does not create Christianity. Christianity is the result of an event, the resurrection, that created a movement, the church, that produced sacred and reliable texts that were collected and bound into a book that we call the Bible. It is our holy scriptures. It is the word of God. It is authoritative in our life. But understand the ways. Now, here's why this is important. Because for some people, this book can be a hindrance or a stumbling block for them to get to Jesus. And for some people that we've engaged with, we've actually created a stumbling block for people to get to Jesus. Let me explain it to you this way. When I'm having conversations with people about spiritual things and I'm trying to direct them to Jesus, like I'm trying to get them to Jesus as soon as I quickly can, put them in a room with Jesus and let him kind of do the work on them. But every once in a while, people start to bring up other stuff. For some reason, when I talk to people, they like to talk about dinosaurs and aliens. I don't know why, but that's where they go, right? And so what do you think that I do with dinosaurs and aliens when I'm talking about Jesus? I take them and I say, hey, that is a great question. Can we put that over here for just a moment and just talk about Jesus? Because if we can do that, then we can come back and we can circle around and talk about like dinosaurs and aliens if that's all right with you. And sometimes they're okay with that. We can just talk about Jesus. Other times they go, no, for whatever reason, dinosaurs are a stumbling block for me to be able to talk about Jesus. And you know what I do in that time? I go, all right, let's talk about dinosaurs. Let's talk about dinosaurs. Let's do that so that I can help get you there. In a similar way, some people come to this conversation and they go, hey, I really want to know about Jesus, but this whole Bible thing gets in my way. Now, what you need to understand is that for somebody who's willing to read the scriptures with you, for somebody who's willing to be able to process through them with you, even if they don't believe it's the word of God, by all means, open up the word of God, have them read these things. There's power in the word of God. There's power in these scriptures. But for some people, they go, because it's the word of God, because it's the Bible, if you will, then I don't have a category for that because I don't believe that that's authoritative. And therefore, it doesn't speak anything into my life. For those people, what we need to do is not create a stumbling block where we go, no, you need to believe this before you can come to Jesus. What we need to do is we need to take the Bible, we need to say, hey, let me put this right here for a moment and let me introduce you to Jesus. Let me tell you the truth that I know about him. Let me reveal to you the things that he's done in my life. And then after exposing you to Jesus, then let's talk about this authoritative work that has all of these validations and truths and it's trustworthy that you can actually be able to follow. You see, sometimes we take a path on this and we actually create stumbling blocks for other people. And when it comes to the word of God, as precious as it is to us, let's not make it a stumbling block for others. Let's verify it in our own life. And if they need help, what we've done today is we've been able to help bridge the gap so that we can have that conversation with them. Now, over the past couple weeks, what we've done is we've talked about the fact that there is a God. We've talked about the reality that Jesus is God, and we've talked about the Bible being the word of God. All of those things attest to the fact that you all are in here right now, that you're listening to this, because you have a desire to be able to seek after him. And through these scriptures that are actually historical, not just religious documents, what we're told, what we're instructed in those scriptures is that we should get together like this on a regular basis. That we should have conversations about Jesus. We should remind people of what he has spoken. We should invite the Holy Spirit to be able to guide us into these things, to be able to actually test the things of this world against what the scriptures themselves say. One of the things specifically it tells us is that whenever we gather, that we should do so in remembrance of the name of Jesus Christ and his work. Because all of us are here only because there's a God who loved us enough to enter into our world, in the form of a man, Jesus, who went to the cross, who died and was resurrected, brought new life, took away our sins, has commissioned his people that wrote these scriptures that were able to be able to reveal him. And we do this all in the name and the banner of Jesus. So what we're going to do right now is we're actually going to take communion together to be able to listen to and abide by and utilize the scriptures as our authority that point back to the man of Jesus who actually is the reason for our being here today. And so as we take this, we take the film off the top and we grab the bread, and the bread represents his body broken for us. And we take this and we eat and we say, thank you, God. Let's pray. And we take the juice, represents his blood shed for us, blood of a new covenant, the very reason that we have a New Testament in the first place. And we say, thank you. Father God, we thank you for this morning. We thank you that you've given us some additional credibility, if we needed it, for the work we call the Bible, for these collection of documents that have been put into the New Testament that have the ability to breathe life into us, to introduce us to the one who saves us. So Father, I pray that that you would allow us to become resolved in our understanding and our belief that the Bible is the Word of God. Help us to figure out the best ways to be able to use and utilize it, to be able to reach other people far from you that you desire to be next to you. Lord, we love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.